Welcome to Rock of Faith. You're about to watch the service of September 27th, Sunday evening with Pastor Jess Tuthill. You can submit prayer requests, offerings, and find everything at our website, roffont.com. The link is in the video description below.
Praise the Lord. Good evening, everyone. It's good to see each one here today. We say God bless you. If you're glad to be here, say amen. Praise the Lord. We're going to go and start our service in prayer. So if you'll stand with me, please, we're going to get started. Amen. And if you will turn to your neighbor and tell him, I love you and you can't do nothing about it. Tell him, I love you and you can't do nothing about it. And if you would, repeat after me and say, this is the best day and the best year that I've ever had. Because Jesus is with me. One more time. This is the best day and the best year that I've ever had because Jesus is with me. Let's give him a clap offering this evening. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's remember all those that need prayer. We have several that still healing up. Was good to see Agnes this morning. That was wonderful. I'm glad she's doing better. Let's lift up Jenna. She's healing from her Achilles surgery. Let's remember all those on the highway. I know we have some that are still traveling, so let's remember those tonight as well. Margo, did you? Okay, let's remember Sharon tonight. Anybody else with a special request? We'll take it to the Lord in prayer. All right. Well, let's do this tonight. Let's join together. Let's believe God together for our service and for these people. Amen. Father, we thank you tonight in the mighty name of Jesus for this wonderful opportunity to be in your house. And Lord, we ask you to bless our service tonight. Lord, we ask you to bless the music portion of our service and the spoken word. Lord, we lift up everyone that's sick in body tonight. God, we ask you to touch them. Thank you for our sister Agnes that she's doing better. Father, in the name of Jesus, we lift up Sharon tonight. God, we ask you to touch her by your mighty power. And Jenna, Lord, let that Achilles tendon heal, Father. Lord, remember Carol Dickey tonight. We pray, Father, that you will bless her. Let her mend properly, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We remember Pastor Dan tonight. He has one more week, I believe, in Indiana and Illinois. God, we ask you to touch them and minister to the need. Touch him. We'll give you the glory, the praise, and the honor. Lord, you said in your word that no weapon formed against us shall prosper. And we give you the glory and the praise and the honor. Bless your people on tonight. Don't let us leave the same way we came, but let us receive a blessing. And we'll give you the glory and the praise and the honor. We ask these things tonight in your name, the name of Jesus, and everyone said, amen. You can be seated tonight if you will. We are going to go ahead and receive our evening tithe and offering. This goes to the expense of our church. We like you to give us unto the Lord, and we know that the Lord will bless you. Amen. Father, we thank you tonight in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we ask you to bless this offering, bless the gift and the giver. Lord, minister to your people tonight, some way, somehow, return it to them, and we'll give you the glory and the praise and honor. We ask these things tonight in your name, the name of Jesus, and everyone said, amen. If you have an offering, please bring it to the storehouse of the Lord. Tonight, we're going to be in 2 Samuel chapter 6. We're going to start in verse 1. This is a very familiar passage of scriptures. You may or may not know it, but we're going to share this story and hope it will be a blessing to you. Again, David gathered, verse 1, together all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. And David arose and went with all the people that were with him from Baal to Judah, a Baal of Judah, to bring up from thence the ark of God, whose name is called by the name of the Lord of hosts that dwelleth between the cherubims. And they set the ark of God upon a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab that was in Gibeah. and Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, drave the new cart. And they brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was at Gibeah, accompanying the ark of God. And Ahio went before the ark. And David and all the house of Israel played before the Lord on all manner of instruments made of fir wood, even on harps and on psalteries and on timbrels and on cornets and on cymbals. And when they came to Nacon's threshing floor, Uzzah put forth his hand to the ark of God and took hold of it, for the oxen shook it. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God smote him there for his error, and there he died by the ark of God. And David was displeased because the Lord had made a breach upon Uzzah, and he called the name of the place Perez Uzzah to this day. And David was afraid of the Lord that day and said, "How shall the ark of the Lord come to me?" So David would not remove the ark of the Lord unto him into the city of David, but David carried it aside unto the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite. And the ark of the Lord continued in the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite, 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. And it was told the king, saying, "The Lord hath blessed the house of Obed-Edom and all that pertaineth unto him, because of the ark of God." So David went and brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom into the city of David with gladness. And it was so that when they bare the ark of the Lord had gone 6 paces, he sacrificed oxen and fatlings. And David danced before the Lord with all his might, and David was girded with a linen ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of a trumpet. And as the ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michal, Saul's daughter, looked through the window and saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart. And they brought the ark of the Lord and set it in his place in the midst of the tabernacle and that David had pitched for it. And David offered burnt offerings and peace offerings before the Lord. Okay, we're gonna stop right there, and there's some more that we could share, and hopefully tonight we'll get to all the things that this story represents. This is a very significant story and a very significant part of David's life. David was anointed with oil by the prophet Samuel in his own hometown, and God had called him out from his brothers. He had several other brothers, and David was tending sheep in the field, and Jesse, David's father, told Samuel, "I have one son that's tending the sheep," and he said, "Go get him." And when Jesse got his son David to come before Samuel, God spoke to Samuel and said, "This is the man that's going to be king over Israel." We're gonna talk about this tonight, that God chose David, and God brought him up as king, and it wasn't easy. And it was several years before David actually had the opportunity to come up to Jerusalem to be the king. At this time, they called it the City of David. And in this particular story, they had not had experience with moving or touching the Ark of the Covenant. For those of you who don't know, the Ark of the Covenant is where they had the Ten Commandments. They had Aaron's rod that budded and bloomed almonds. They had manna from the wilderness, where it rained down manna from heaven. And they had all of this in this ark, and they had cherubims on each side. That's an angel with 4 wings, and they each touched each other in the front and in the back. And in the middle, there was a seat, and it's called the mercy seat. And it was in the holiest of all, and that's where the Lord sat. That's where the Lord's presence was. And so David had a tent set up, and they were getting ready to put the Ark of the Covenant in the holiest of all. And on their journey there, they had put the Ark of the Covenant on an oxen cart, and that's not the way they were supposed to transport it. In one of the other books of the Bible, it tells us that as they transported the Ark of the Covenant, the priests were supposed to carry it. And when they allowed the oxen to take the Ark of the Covenant, they shook the cart, and the Ark of the Covenant began to tilt. And so Uzzah reached over and touched the Ark of the Covenant, and when he did, he died. And he died before the Ark of the Covenant that day. And so David didn't know what to do, and so they took the Ark of the Covenant to this house called Obed-Edom's house and left it there temporarily until David decided what he was going to do. And I want to stop right here tonight and share how significant this story is. We who are preachers need to understand that God wants us to minister the Word of God according to His direction. God doesn't want us to say just whatever we want to say. God doesn't want us to handle the holy things and sacred things in just any kind of a fashion. He wants us to preach the gospel the way that He wrote it down in the book. He wants us to handle God's word correctly. And in this case, the priests spent many years in studying the word of God and prepared themselves on handling the Ark of the Covenant. They also were prepared in making sacrifices. They also prepared in burning incense. They also were prepared in many of the things of the house of God. And so when people brought their partitions before the Lord, they already knew what they had to do. Sometimes if a person committed a certain sin, they had to bring turtle doves or a goat or a sheep or oxen or whatever, and they had to sacrifice it before the Lord. And so the priests were already prepared on how to handle each individual item. And so when they came into the house of God, the priests themselves were responsible for helping the people, for praying for the people and ministering to the people. Many people today do not care about the real true word of God. Many people don't believe that it really is the word of God. And they handle it any kind of way that they want to handle it. And in this case, by their mishandling God's direct commandment, and that is for the priest to carry the Ark of the Covenant, that when Uzzah touched it, even though he was ignorant of the fact, God struck him dead because he was not supposed to be touching the Ark of the Covenant. It's a sacred thing. They had it in one time. They put the Ark of the Covenant in the house of Dagon. And Dagon was a Philistine god. And he was just really a statue made out of plaster or stone or whatever. And they put the Ark of the Covenant in there. And in the morning when they went go and look in to see what was going on, the statue had been pushed over. And the presence of God made fun of the statue because a statue can't help you. You could pray, go make yourself a statue and pray to that statue. It's not going to help you. There's many religions where they have artifacts and statues, and they're dead. They're made out of wood or stone or something. And you could pray till you're 195, and it's not going to do anything for you because it's dead. But the Spirit of God is alive. How many know that tonight? We serve a living God. Amen. The Spirit of God is alive. And so we have the wonderful opportunity to pray to a living God, but we have to do it correctly. I want to take just a few minutes tonight. At this point in my life, I've known several people that said things about God that they shouldn't say. And they paid the price for doing so. There's one man I know that He got angry with God, and he knew better. He was a minister. And he went outside, and he shook his fist at God, and he said all kinds of manner of evil against God. This man, he had owned a business, and he owned he had a truck, and he had several other things. In a short period of time, he had an accident. He went completely crazy. He lost his business, and he ran down the street completely naked, doing just crazy, crazy stuff because of what he said about God. And what people don't know is you can't say anything about God and have him respect it. And lots of people I know have lost things. They've had critical incidents happen to them because they know better than to say things about God like that, but they said them anyway. The Word of God is sacred. It's holy. It's supposed to be treated as such. In this case, when they put the Ark of the Covenant in the holiest of all, Aaron, amen, when he was alive, was the only one that could go in there. The high priest was allowed to only go in there once a year, and they tied a rope onto him, and if he had any disobedience or iniquity at all, he fell over dead in the holiest of all, and they drug him out with the rope because if they had gone in there themselves, they would have fell over dead. We're talking about a living God. We're talking about a God that has written his word, and he's holy and sacred, and he wants his word respected in the same fashion. And I have met many preachers that once had ministries, and they said certain things, and their ministry was wiped out. There's people today, in fact, I know a guy that was once praise and worship leader, and now he's working in a regular business. He's no longer there for the things he said about God. Why else would he not be in a ministry? Amen. And so I'm in this situation, ignorance is not good. The Bible said, my people perish all day long for a lack of knowledge. He didn't say they got sick. He didn't say they'd have a little bit of trouble. He said, my people perish all day long for a lack of knowledge. And so we're not allowed to preach something that's not true. I've heard people say, I pronounce a thousandfold blessing upon you. You can't give a thousandfold blessing. First of all, you don't get that. And the Bible says it's 30, 60, or 100-fold. And you cannot ordain someone personally, bring them in, and call them to the ministry. They can be ordained. They can learn what they're supposed to do. But God calls people into the ministry. I have seen people actually step down from the ministry because they said, I was not called by God. My mother called me. My grandfather called me. So-and-so called me, whatever, whoever called me, and God did not call me to the ministry. And he laid down his ministry, and he walked out. And I find that that God is wanting us, as we study the Word, to recognize how powerful the Word of God is when we use it correctly. It was not written for us to abuse, and God does not like to be misrepresented. If you work for a company today and they gave you information and you're a salesman and they sent you out to represent that company, they want you to represent the company the way they meant for you to represent it. And so they'll give you information and you tell whoever it is you're trying to sell this to what the company does and what they don't do. Amen. I'll give you a good example of this. My son James worked for Mark Christopher. And they sold cars and still do. And eventually my son actually wrote the manual for how you sell cars for Mark Christopher. Anyway, this man promised, a salesman promised some people that came on the lot some things about this car they wanted to buy. And he did not tell them the truth. It was a very expensive car. And they told him, oh, that's no problem. They'll allow you to do this, that, and the other. Anyway, he went from one lie to another all the way down the list. Amen. And so when they were brought into the office and they were trying to negotiate for the car, the owner found out what this man said, and he got fired on the spot for lying to the customer. And so the salesman brought suit against Mark Christopher, and Mark Christopher sent my son into court to represent them while he went there. And so the judge looked at this man and said, did you lie to the customer? And the man said, well, judge, you have to lie to people if you want to sell cars. And the judge looked at my son, and my son just did this. And the judge hit the gavel and said, case dismissed. And my son walked out of the court free because he didn't do anything bad. The man lied. Hello, you can't do that. That's one of the commandments, by the way, if you don't know. Amen. Thou shalt not lie or bear false witness. Amen. And so when I'm dealing with God today and I'm praying, I'm trying to realize that God is wanting me to be knowledgeable about his word. And when I pray before a living God, he wants me to pray correctly. He expects me to know what this says. And the only way that I can do that is if I read it. And if I get under some teachers and they can teach me correctly. I've been in plenty of churches and I've heard people preach sermons and they're completely erroneous. They're not true. They're not the word of God. I heard a man preach a whole service on he didn't want to turn the other cheek. The Bible says, amen, you're supposed to turn the other cheek. Well, you could preach all day long. You know, you don't have to do this or that or the other. But when the Bible says it and you preach against it, now you've lied. It's awful quiet. Amen. Now you've lied, and you've lied in the presence of God. Ananias and Sapphira lied in the presence of God about selling their property, and they both fell over dead in the presence of God. I'm not messing with God. I'm telling you right now, I'm not messing with God. I'm not going to say stuff that he didn't say because I know he could take care of himself. In one night, they sent one angel, killed 185,000 people. Amen. I'm just a little speck on the planet. Can I get a witness? Amen. I'm not going to lie, cheat, or steal anybody. Amen. And I've already promised God the moon. Can I get a witness? Amen. Promised him everything. Amen. So I want to be careful what I say about God. And so we need to realize the word of God here, the reason that that happened to Uzzah is he was uneducated in the word of God. He was not taught properly, and he wasn't supposed to take the word of God, amen, and abuse it, which he did. And so now he has to pay the price. Under the Old Testament, they were under the law. And you got to understand, when God said something and it produced death or some kind of punishment, that's what happened to the person. And in many cases, Achan was one. He stole a wedge of silver and did some other stuff on their way out of Egypt into the promised land. And so they found out that Achan did this. They stole the stuff. They asked him, did you steal it? And he said, I did. And so they took he and his family out to the edge of the city, and they stoned him to death because of what his sin was. That was the requirement. Amen. I'll say this. We don't have many kids in here. Amen. If you had a rebellious teenager and they wouldn't respond, they took them out to the edge of the city and they killed them because they wouldn't respond to discipline and obedience. Amen. That's harsh punishment. Can I get a witness? Amen. But that was the law. That was what God said. And so they had to come under subjection to these things. And unfortunately today, so many people think that the Bible is just words and stories. I've had lots of people tell me, in fact, in one particular man told me, he said, the Bible is just hearsay. And I wanted to take a couple steps back because I thought lightning was going to get the guy for saying such a thing about the Bible. He said, it's just hearsay. We're in a position tonight that most of us do not have a lot of money. Most of us don't have a lot of material possessions, and we need someone to help us. And so the more we study the Word of God, just like I shared this morning, that we need God to bless us, amen, and we need Him to help us in our difficulties. We don't need $1 billion. Can I get a witness? We don't need to lie to anybody and tell them if they give us $1,000, they'll get $10,000 next week. We don't need to go there. But the real reason that God is doing things, number one, is He wants us to develop character. He wants us to believe God, and He wants us to act on the Word of God. The Bible calls Abraham the father of faith. And for two reasons that God called Abraham to be the father of faith is, number one, he was going to teach his children the Word of God. He was going to teach them how to be obedient to God's instructions. The other thing was, he really did believe God, and when God spoke something to him, he acted upon what God said. He didn't just hear it and say amen and stay the same. God said, I want you to come out from your kinfolk and your family into the land that I'll show you. So Abraham went out and loaded the jalopy, and can I get a witness, amen, and put the people in the chairs and did the Beverly Hillbilly thing, can I get a witness, and they got out of there. They left. And so they went to Haran first. He stayed there for a while, but that's not where God called him, and so he went further, amen, into the promised land later on. He finally had a son. God promised him a son. It took 25 years to get the son, and then God said, I want you to go sacrifice him. So God and Abraham, because of God's instruction, God already gave him a promise that his son's descendants were going to be like the stars in heaven or like the sand by the seashore. And so while Abraham was taking his son out to Mount Moriah to be sacrificed, he told everybody, I'm going to take my son out, and then we're both going to return, signifying the fact that even if he had to kill him or if he died, God would raise him from the dead. And so they went out and they were going to sacrifice him. He put him, made the altar, tied him up, put the fire on, or wood under for the fire. And he would raise the knife and he was going to kill him. And the angel of the Lord said, you don't have to do that. I see you have not withheld your son. He was a man of faith. Most people wouldn't even have taken their son out there. They're not going to do that. By the time they got to the New Testament, they used to bring lame animals, blind, terrible creatures that weren't, you know, they were terrible, and they were supposed to bring the best of their flock, and they brought the worst. And then they take them to the temple and sell them for outrageous prices, and God was upset with it because they're getting further and further and further and further away from the truth and the promises of God. We understand, and I understand tonight, it's unfortunate, but people are getting further and further and further from what God's Word really says and what it really means. And one of these days, they're going to have to pay the price. Whether God settles up today or later, they're going to have to give account of lying and misrepresenting God. Amen. I don't want to misrepresent God, and so it takes study. Amen. When we went to the school with Pastor Dan was constantly instructing us on what it said. We read in the Hebrew and the Greek. He'd read the definition of the word, and many times we were amazed at what the word really did say. I've shared it many times, but the word grace, I was taught, meant unmerited favor. And that's only half of it. It meant unmerited favor and empowerment. So that's how you become a Christian. You not only get unmerited favor, He empowers you to become a Christian. Amen. There's tons of things that God represents in the Word of God the way that people teach it, amen, they don't tell the truth. It's not the truth about God's Word, and it's not what God is trying to express as how we're supposed to live our lives. And once you start getting away from the truth of the matter, amen. I will say this, a very famous man in our organization, they have to deal with severe problems in the ministry, even in our own church. Worldwide, there's lots of people that have disobeyed the Lord. Some through morality, some through theft, some through whatever reasons. And you cannot continue to be a pastor if you violate certain rules. And so this man was speaking, and he was one of the leaders of our organization. But he had told his people and ministers and others that it was okay to drink. And what happened under his ministry is that people began to be immoral. People began to lie, cheat, and steal. People began to get into trouble because of the alcohol. And just in case you don't know, alcohol changes your reaction time. Alcohol changes your decision-making process. Hello. Alcohol is called being intoxicated. That's poison, by the way, if you want to look it up. Amen. You're putting poison in your system. You can't drink and drive. You can't drink and operate equipment. A woman cannot drink and have a baby. They just had a whole thing on TV. I don't know if you saw it or not, about women who drink excessively while they're having a baby and what the damages can result from women who do that. Amen. And it's obvious, amen, that it's a terrible condition. And I have done funerals for people who died with cirrhosis of the liver, one in particular who died at 46 years old from drinking alcohol. It killed him. And I don't know, within the last year or two, if you heard this story, that at USC there was a young man that went to a party, and I guess they were doing binge drinking, but he got alcohol poisoning and he died while he was at the party. So now I can drink all the water I want right now. If you want to go get a hose, I'll see how much water I can put down, and I'll guarantee I won't die. Can I get a witness? Amen. I can just drink so much, but I mean, I could drink a whole gallon of this stuff. I'm not going to die. There's no poison in it. I could drink it, amen, and then take a deep breath and drink some more. I'm not going to die. But if you do it with alcohol, you're taking a great chance that you could die from the poison that's in the alcohol. Amen. I'm preaching to me. Amen. Now, God wrote this book so that we could follow it, not so we could disobey it, not so we could do whatever we wanted to do. If you want to do whatever you want to do, don't call yourself a Christian. Many times today, there are organizations that do not follow the commandments and they still call themselves Christians, but they're no longer Christians. They have changed their tenets of faith. They've changed what they believe about God. And in Revelation, it said, if you alter or change it, amen, your name will be taken out of the Lamb's Book of Life and you will no longer be a part of the kingdom. And there are churches that are no longer churches, they're cults. They have fallen away from God. They think they're saved. And this is what Pastor Dan says about deception all the time, is that you don't know that you're wrong. You think you're okay, but you're deceived. So you think you're okay and you're wrong. And now you're going to face judgment for it. You're heading headlong into a face-to-face confrontation with the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you get there, it's not going to be good. You have disobeyed the word of the Lord. Amen. My intent tonight is to present to you real life stories of the difference between obedience and disobedience. In this story, as David began to dance before the Lord, his wife came out and saw him dancing and made fun of him and despised him in her heart. And so at the end of his episode of dancing, which he rejoiced before the Lord, they had a conversation, And she could no longer have children the whole rest of her life. She had no children because she made fun of David while he danced. Many of the things, especially in the Pentecostal church, we don't see it as much anymore. But dancing and rejoicing and the tambourine and the guitar and the violin and the organ and whatever else you can play has been a part of the church service. In the Old Testament, they used all the instruments, a full-blown orchestra, to praise and worship the Lord. And they humbled themselves before God. Can I get a witness? Amen. And they rejoiced, and it was okay. Today, if you praise the Lord, they want to put you out of the church. If you have a burden and you start crying, they want to put you out of the church. If you have difficulties, they want to put you out because they only want people who don't have difficulties. They want people with lots of money and no problems. And we're here because God's got power. Come on. He's able to change your situation. Amen. Tonight, you could be in trouble tonight, and by tomorrow, you could be completely free from your situation. Amen. I'm preaching to me. Hallelujah. God's intent, amen, in this passage of Scripture makes me realize how critical and how important my job is to tell people, first of all, about the gift of eternal life, about the mercy of God and the graciousness and the wonderfulness of God. But on the other hand, there's a judgment coming. On the other hand, there's discipline when you disobey. And I don't care how nice you are. I don't care if you wear a new suit every week. Come on. I don't care how you look if you disobey. And I've seen plenty of people that look good on the outside that lie. Amen. If their lips are moving, they're lying. Can I get a witness? Amen. They're not telling the truth. It's not going to prosper or profit them anything. Amen. We're here because we believe in God and we believe in His Word. We're here because we pray in line with God's Word. We do not try to misrepresent the Lord because we know what will happen if we misrepresent Him and misrepresent His Word. He's a holy God. He's not going to allow anything that like people say today, they say, if you got saved once, you're saved forever. He's not going to allow ungodliness to get into heaven. It can't get in there. The devil was in heaven and sinned and got kicked out. I don't know what makes people think that they can sin down here and get in. One of the ones that was in there, amen, he was walking on the streets of gold. He was singing in the choir, leading in, amen, and they kicked him out of heaven for sin. I don't know what the reverse will be. The reverse is the same thing. Sin, sin, and the same results. You're staying here. Amen. You're going to be eternally separated from God in the lake of fire. Amen. There are many things in the Bible, but this is one story that I thought was very critical because I want to get blessed. And here, as I shared this morning, both in Deuteronomy 28 and Matthew chapter 5, it tells us when we respond the correct way, we'll be blessed. It doesn't say to tell people, if you give us a lot of money, you'll be blessed. It tells us, blessed are they who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. On and on and on. It gives us a word-for-word definition. If we do these things, this is the result of it. It does not say anywhere that if you give money, you'll get blessed, and you can skip all the instructions of righteousness and have God bless you. You can't do it. It's not in God's Word. Amen. You cannot receive the blessing of God if you're disobedient. And you can argue all day with me if you want to, but you're going to have to contend with the Word of God. It's something that you cannot get away from. I shared it before many times. I'll just share it again. When I was a young pastor, a man came to me and he was debating with me the Word of God because he wanted to commit a particular sin. And so he kept going on and on and on with me. And finally, I just said to him, you know, it doesn't make one lick of difference what I think. I could tell you it's okay to sin if you want to sin. But the problem is, the Bible calls it a sin, and whatever I think is nothing. I'm nobody. Who am I to contradict God's word? And so I told him, if you do that, you've sinned and you're going to be in danger of the judgment. And he got up and left, but I said, it doesn't change the fact that what the Bible says. And there's church after church after church after church that wants to be politically correct. And if you don't believe me, just get on YouTube and start looking up people's names. And they've said time after time, whatever the government tells us to do, that's what we're going to do. And I'm telling you, I'm going to do what the Bible says, irregardless what the government tells me to do. And I'll either have a ministry here or in jail, but I'm going to have a ministry of preaching the gospel. Amen. If it makes somebody mad, it's just going to have to make them mad. You cannot change the word of God. You cannot make somebody a Christian that God didn't make a Christian. If they're not born again, they're not going to glory. I don't care who they are. You can call your name, organization of such and so, and if it's not in here, you could put it on the building, but it's not who you are. Amen. And I don't understand why people don't want to obey what the Bible says. Now, we're going to say this, and I've said it many times. This is one of the reasons of the last day plagues, is that people are going to refuse to repent. They're going to refuse to admit they're wrong, and they're going to keep saying things that they think are okay and they're not. And so things are going to begin to happen, and if you had ever turned on the Weather Channel, you ought to do it sometime. You'll begin to see some of the things that God talked about are going to happen to the United States. I don't know if you've seen the hurricanes, the tornadoes, the floods, the fires that are in the northern part of Washington, Idaho, Montana, California. Fires that burn untold thousands of acres. Amen. I'm telling you the truth. Amen. The blessing of God is leaving America because America is leaving God. The blessing of God is leaving us, not the real Christian. You'll always be blessed if you're a real Christian. But as a nation, the things that we are doing that are contradicting the word of God, we are paying the price for. And it happens over and over and over again. I've had lots of people tell me you could do thus and so and nothing will happen. And I watch them crash and burn. You know, I know a man right now, I don't know, I haven't seen him in a long while, but because of what he's done, he has two felonies, and if he does anything else again, he will be gone 25 to life. And so all the while that he went to court and he was supposed to go to classes and all the things he was supposed to do, he didn't do. He's in danger of spending his whole rest of his life in prison for what he's done in the past if he commits another felony. There's other people I know that do things and they think that they can get away with it. And if it's against the law and it's a felony, you're going to go to prison. And I don't care who you are, they'll go. You'll go to court, you'll do whatever. But if they find you guilty, you're going to go to prison. You can't get away from it. And this is what God is trying to express to me. He does not want to be misrepresented. He wants us to act as Christians should act. Hello? And live the way that God intended for us to live. There's no other alternative. There's nothing else that we're allowed to do. Go ahead and get on the freeway tonight. Take your car and drive 100 miles an hour on the freeway. Go ahead and do that. Get on there and do 100 miles an hour. Oh, yeah, you'll see red lights. And depending on that man's nature, you may see the jail, too. Amen. They may take you right straight to jail. Hello. You can't go out here and wait till some store closes and break the window and go in and rob the place. Hello. It's against the law. It's wrong. It's not what God told us. I have spent over 40 years having difficulties. And my responsibility is to go into my prayer closet and pray. And if it's over my head, we get other people to join with us so that we can overcome the situation, whatever we're facing. We don't steal from somebody. We don't lie to somebody. We don't go there. I wish you could be with me. I wish you could just be with me some week. And people come to me and want to borrow money. And it's not, some people are very good. If I loan them money, they'll pay me back. They'll pay the church back. But there are people that have the wildest stories you ever heard in your life. If you loan me so much money, I'm going to get a lot of money next week or in a couple of days, and I'll pay you back. Well, I don't get anything back. And then they come back again with another wild story. Will you loan me money? No, I'm not going to loan you any money. You didn't pay me back before. And that's the craziest story I ever heard. Hello. And they're taking money from the church. It's different. But what's sad to me is there's no blessing on the person's life. Do you understand what I'm saying? And so instead of praying and seeking God and doing it right, they try to con somebody out of their money. What a shame. People do it in church all the time. Preachers do it all the time. I met a man. I know him right. I know him tonight. I can't take you to him, but I know who he is. He owned a truck. And he took the fan belt off the truck. He'd go to a certain busy corner. And he put his fan belt behind the seat. And people would come by and say, "What's the matter?" He said, "Well, my fan belt broke and I need $2, $5, $20, whatever you can spare to help me get another fan belt." He made $200 a day, amen, and he didn't even need a fan belt. He had it sitting behind the seat until the cop found him. Hello. And looked behind his seat. Hello. What do you think they call it a con for? It's a con. Well, guess where he went? He went to prison. He didn't go to jail. He went to prison. At $200 a day, it's $1,000 a week or more. He made $4,000 or $5,000 a month robbing people. It's a con. I'm preaching to me tonight. It is really critical to me about how that God wants us to teach people properly. And you do not know how many times I've had criticism when someone asks me, "Are you Pentecostal?" I say, "Yes." And they say, "Do you speak in tongues?" And I say, "Yes." They don't want to hear that. I've had people tell me that the miracles left when the apostles died. And I tell them that the apostles had nothing to do with the miracles, but Jesus took 39 stripes in Pilate's judgment hall to give us miracles, and they're still in effect today because they didn't have anything to do with the apostles. You could kill all apostles, kill them all from point A to all the way to the end, and there's still miracles in the earth because it's based on Jesus Christ and not apostles. If you base anything on mankind, you're going to be in trouble because mankind is going to mess up sooner or later, and he can't heal you if he had to. Do you know a real true doctor will say the same thing? The only thing a doctor can do for you, or even a surgeon, is take the bad part out. If you heal, you're going to heal because God put it in your body to heal. I wish I could get a witness. A real honest to goodness doctor will tell you so. He can't heal you. Amen. I find myself amazed at certain things, but I'm not going down the same road that somebody else is going down. I don't want to lose out. I've spent over 40 years, been 43 years, more than that, as a Christian. What would it be like if you spent all these years and then fell at the end? Lost out at the end because you got tired of praying. You got tired of reading your Bible. I had a man tell me that. I had a man tell me I got tired of praying in tongues. Preacher. And he said, I don't do that anymore. And he found a way to get some money. Can I get a witness? Hello? So I don't pray in tongues anymore because I found a way to get some money. Finagled it. Hello, I'm preaching to me tonight. I'm not going to do that. That's not what God intended for me to do. And sometimes it's difficult in getting from point A to point B because there's a devil out there and he's got lots of cousins and he doesn't want me to be blessed. And if I'm lazy and I only want to pray 5 minutes a day, then that's all I'm going to get. But if I believe, amen, that Jesus gave power, delivered me and gave me power when I got saved, and the Bible says, according to Colossians, he defeated all principality and power, and then he gave me authority over them all. That means that if I apply myself the way I'm supposed to, then I will get victory. Hello. So I want to get victory tonight. I want to worship the Lord. Now, I don't understand why people get upset when someone gets happy in church. You can get happy at the ball game. You can get happy at a dance or party. You can get happy driving your car, put your music up. I heard people, their stereo, you can hear it, amen, from Cucamonga here, amen. I've seen people do things and get happy, and you get up in church and get happy, they put you out. Hello. We don't want to be happy. We don't allow happy people in this church. We want ugly, awful, mean-looking people in this church. Miserable, sad creatures, human beings that... Oh, get out of here. Can I get a witness? You can't cry in church. There's no crying in church. Hello. I was in a church service. And this woman came in the service. I wasn't the pastor or anything part to do with this church. And this woman wasn't just crying. She was absolutely sobbing. And as I was praying, I thought, you know, I could help that woman. I have information that I could probably help her with. And God said, you can't go over there. He said, this ministry won't help her. Nobody's going to her, and they won't let you go either. And I knew it was true. I knew the ministry there. They wouldn't let me do it. And that lady cried and cried and cried, and the people around her tried to comfort her best they could. But nobody ministered to that lady. Did not help her. Did not comfort her. And I thought, you know, it was the last day I went to that church, by the way. That was the last time I ever entered the doors of that place. And if you feel bad, you lost a loved one, or you're just in pain, God put those tear ducts in your eyes for a reason. And if you hurt bad enough, you will weep. I remember we had to take our little dog, Mac. Amen. His kidneys were failing. And you just can't fix kidneys. That's all I can tell you. And Linda and I went to take Mac up. We had to put him to sleep. We had to do that with a collie we had. I would rather take a beating than to do that. I love those dogs. I'm fierce. Amen. I don't want to do it, but I don't want them to suffer either. And the Bible says it's good that a man regards his beast. So we had to take that poor little puppy up there. I would somebody hit me with a two before as to go there and do that. But it was the best thing for him that he was suffering. And we had to put him down because it was his time. He had to go. We did it same thing with our collie. We had her years ago when we used to live on G Street. One of the best dogs we ever had. We used to play with the boys. She would grab a frisbee or a towel and run away from the boys, and the boys would chase her all over the yard when they were just little guys. A beautiful dog. She never, ever bit them. You could pull her tail, her ears, yell at her. do whatever you want to do. She never bit anybody that I know of. Wonderful dog, beautiful dog. But if you got anywhere near our yard, she would bark her loudest bark, and you would think she'd take your leg off if you put one step in there. Beautiful, beautiful dog. My intent in studying the Word of God is I want the truth out of it. I've met too many people. We're going to close with this. I met too many people, and I keep meeting them even now. They want to go to a church that allows them to do what they want to do. They don't want to read the Bible and do what it says. They want to go to a church that lets them do whatever they want to do. Well, what good is that? You can't go out on the baseball field on a real team and play whatever you want to play. You can't take a ball and throw it over the first baseman's head and expect that guy to be called out. He's not going to be called out. You'd say, well, I can't throw the ball straight. Too bad. That guy's going to second or third. Amen. There's rules to it. Hello. You can't go out there and do crazy stuff. I don't want 3 strikes. I want 57 strikes. Just keep throwing it. Amen. You get 3 strikes, you're out. Can I get a witness? Amen. It's rules, and I found that God is the same way. Amen. Hallelujah. I've had a few spankings in my life. I shared this morning. I shared this story before, but I went one time. I had a prayer meeting before I went to work. My boss would send me to L.A. in a bobtail, and I'd make a bunch of deliveries and pickups, and I just didn't want to do it one day. And I prayed. I said, God, I don't want to go to L.A. today. They better not ask me. I ain't going. Forget it. Amen. Amen. I was walking up the ramp to work, and my boss, he never ever did this before, he came out of the building and pointed at me and said, you're going to L.A. today. And I thought about that because I'm trying to tell Almighty God what to do, and here Almighty God is telling me what I'm going to do. I complained all the way there, hello, and all the way back, hello. I know you never did that, but I did. And then I decided on my way back, I better not do that again. I better keep my big mouth shut. Amen. I'm going to keep my big mouth shut. Whatever they tell me to do, I'm going to do it. And I find here David learned his lessons. When David did something wrong, he learned from God to correct his behavior. He didn't just keep doing the same thing over and over and over and over. He listened to God. God told him what to do. And you never find David doing it again. You'll never see him do it again. He gets corrected. He went to the threshing floor once. He lost 185,000 people once. Lots of things happened to David when the issue with Bathsheba, and he went through all the stuff with Absalom. And all the things that he went through, he got corrected for his disobedience. God did not exclude him from disobedience. He had to take his spanking like everybody else. But even at that, he still was the best king that Israel ever had. And I want to learn how to become a better Christian. Life is getting harder and more difficult for a lot of people. And even now, we see very few people here tonight. And there's people that we know that are desperate, that should be in the house of God. They need prayer. And it's hard to get them into the presence of God. And yet we know people, we've laid hands upon them, and the very difficulty that was so much on their behalf, God brought them deliverance because they came and requested prayer, and God brought them deliverance. Amen. We have the opportunity tonight to be a prayer warrior. God dealt with me this week about being a prayer warrior. A warrior isn't somebody that prays 5 minutes a day. If you are a real warrior of any type, if you belong to some army, go down to one of these training bases and see what you have to do to become a Marine or Army or Navy or whatever. See what they make you do. Oh, man, you got to run and run and run and push-ups and all kinds of stuff. And you better do what that sergeant tells you to do. Amen. They told me, I know a man that was in the Navy, and they had to go off the, I don't know what they call it, the big, huge ship, aircraft carrier. They made them jump off the aircraft carrier into the ocean. That might be a couple hundred feet or more. Amen. That's a long way. And when you hit the water at 200 feet, amen, that's not like hitting it when you just dive into your pool, amen. Oh, man, it is hard. But if Sergeant so-and-so tells you to jump, you got to jump. Or you'll be sitting in the brig, amen. Amen. I love the Word of God and the potential for me to have a good day and a good week is ahead of me. I was watching a story this week, and I'll close with this, and we're going to pray. This man suffered, and it's just a story. It's not reality. It was just a story. It was on TV. He suffered the loss of a wife and a daughter, and he kept looking back at his life because he lost a wife and a daughter. And he had this dream, and his daughter came to him in a dream and said to him, you keep looking back, and you don't have to look back anymore. Your life is ahead of you. Your future is what's ahead of you. We're okay. We're finished. We've run our race. But what you have is ahead of you. Do you understand that tonight? What we have is ahead of us. Amen. And the same Savior that delivered us time and time again in the past is going to deliver us in the future. Hello? There's going to be a blessing out there. I wish you would smile at your neighbor and tell them there's going to be a blessing out there. There's going to be a blessing. God's going to help you get there. Your future is what's most important. Can you do one thing about your past? Oh, if I could change stuff in my past, I would do it in a hot second. Hello, anybody out there with me? If I could change some stuff that I said or did in the past, I'd do it like ASAP. But I can't do that. But I can look forward. And 1 John said that if I'll confess my sin, He's faithful and just to forgive me of my sin and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. And so my future is what's out there. And God wants me to represent just like Abraham did. Faith says it's all right. Faith says whatever God said he's going to do, he's going to do it. And so that's what I want. I don't want to sit here and be depressed. Can I get a witness? You just think about all you did in the past. Oh, don't do that. You'll get depressed in a hurry. You'll get depressed in a hurry. All that stuff we did was terrible. And I didn't do what some people did. I know some people probably did worse than me. But I still feel terrible about what I did. When I got saved, I cried and cried and cried and cried about what I did. And I didn't kill anybody or rob any banks or whatever. But for 21 years, I didn't know the Lord. And I had 21 years of sin that needed to be forgiven. I don't know how you feel. I cried and I cried and I cried and I cried. Lord, please forgive me. I'm so ashamed of what I did. Some people now, they want to tell people what they did in the past. Bank robbers and stuff. People ask me what I did in the past. I don't want to say nothing. I'm too ashamed of it. You want to ask me what I did? We'll go back to when I was 21 and we'll go forward from there. But we're not going past that. Amen. Because I wasn't saved. I'm not telling. Someone said, I want to know. Do you know I know some people? I've known anywhere from 4 to 6 generations of people. And there's some things about people that I don't know today because they didn't want to tell me. And I've never asked them anything about it. There's situations that happened, I know, but I don't know what it was. and they didn't want to tell me. I don't go and try to pry. I didn't hire a private investigator. Hello? I want to find out what you did when you were 15. Hello? Ain't none of my business. If you don't want to tell me, don't tell me. I wish I could get a witness. Amen. I did not say a word, and I'm not going to. I don't care. It's done anyway. God forgave you of it. And now we have a future, and the word of God is out there. Let's not misrepresent Jesus. Let's tell the truth about the word of God. And if somebody gets mad at us for being Pentecostal, let them get mad at us. Blessed are you if men will say all manner of evil against you falsely. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. Somebody going to say something bad about you. Amen. Amen. Ern Baxter. Sister Mary Lee gave me a tape by Ern Baxter. He used to be a famous evangelist. And he belonged to this organization. And he went to their convention one year. He was supposed to be the national youth leader. They were going to put him in. Great man of God. He was very humble. And he was going to go and start at least a nationwide ministry. And when he went to the convention, someone lied about him when they were in their negotiations or whatever. So he said he went into his prayer room, and he said he had his Gethsemane. Can I get a witness? Amen. He said this was the hardest thing he ever faced. This is Gethsemane, and he travailed, and he did his prayer, and he came out of that. He went back the next day to the convention, and somebody else lied about him. And so he said, I had another Gethsemane, and he went back to his prayer room, and he began to pray. And he said the last count was 9,432 Gethsemanes. Can I get a witness? Amen. He's had so many people talk about it that he really can't add them all up. Amen. He was a wonder evangelist. He went to Canada. He left the convention, and he was terribly disillusioned. And he went to Canada, and this was many, many, many years ago. He went to an old cabin, and he said what the bed bugs didn't get, the fleas got, and what the fleas didn't get, the something else got. And the only thing he had was bacon and bacon grease and something else to eat while he was there. But in his time of prayer, he said, God put some iron in my soul. And God told him, he said, I'm going to give you a place to walk. In other words, I'm giving you a ministry. And he said the real strength from his ministry came from his time in Canada, not from having some easy thing to go through. Tremendous. He said, for whatever strength I had, like a caterpillar getting through the cocoon to go be a butterfly, that's what happened to him while he was out in Canada. He became a great minister, and he had a very special thing about eagles that he talked about. It was very funny but yet true spiritual truth about it. And I used to love that. Sister Mary Lee gave me a cassette. I've listened to it I don't know how many times. Wonderful, wonderful man of God. But we're here tonight, and you have a choice to become a better Christian. And I don't know about anybody else. I'm so sick of people being babies. I'm so sick of listening to stuff on TV where they start in kindergarten and stay there. And here I am. Next week, I'm going to have to fight devils. Can I get a witness? I'm going to have a fist fight with I don't know how many devils. I don't need milk. I don't need, amen, kindergarten. I need somebody to tell me what thus saith the Lord, and we need to get out there and whip the devil by the word of God and end up next week with victory. Amen. I don't need it. Amen. It's a shame. Amen. I've gone places, and as soon as the man begins to speak, and I watch it on TV, it's kindergarten. It's stuff I learned the first 2 years I was a Christian. And I'm like, and people are shouting and praising. And I thought, where you been? I get up and I've got a battle. Amen. Isn't the devil at their house? The devil mess with him? I don't think so. If he shows up, come on. The first thing that I do when my feet hit the floor is, Lord Jesus, it's another day and I'm going to need your help. Amen. Yeah. Amen. We need to kill the devil today. If you show me how to kill the devil, I'll kill him for you. Amen. I can stop him. I can resist him and make him leave. I can do that. I always say, if God give me a grant, if he let the devil be human for a while, I'd kill him for sure. I'd kill him for sure. I wouldn't care. I'd go to jail tonight. If he is a human being, I'd kill him, shoot him on the sidewalk, and sit on the curb and wait for the police to come and get me. I'd kill that sucker. Hello? Amen. Amen. He'd be a dead devil. Can I get a witness? Amen. Anyway, I had fun tonight. I hope I did something to help you tonight. Would you bow your heads with me? We're going to close in prayer. Thank you for coming tonight. I want to thank you all for being here tonight. Amen. Father, we thank you tonight in the mighty name of Jesus, and we thank you for your goodness to us. Lord, as I read tonight, how critical it is for us to obey you and follow your word. May you continually open our hearts to what the word of God really means. Lord, we don't want kindergarten. We want to grow up and mature. And our future's ahead of us, and our past is gone. So God, allow your spirit to lead us and guide us and direct us. And Lord, we'll give you all the glory and the praise and the honor. Lord, it's such a great privilege to be a Christian. Lord, we represent you. We represent the Son of the living God. Just like somebody in a company today would like us to represent them correctly, we know more than ever you want us to represent you the way you would be pleased with. So pour out your spirit upon us. Let us be used in the kingdom of heaven, and let us tell people the truth so that they can escape the fires of hell and obtain the gift of eternal life and be with you forever and forever. Lord, we give you glory, praise, and honor tonight. We ask these things in your name, the name of Jesus, and everyone said, Amen. Praise the Lord. Anybody tonight that would like prayer, we'll be glad to pray with you. Anyone at all, we'll be glad to take time. If you want prayer, go ahead, come on, and we'll pray with you. Amen. Praise the Lord. Would you stand with me? We're going to go ahead and dismiss in a word of prayer. Did you get something out of this tonight? Say amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We want to see greater and greater things happen in the kingdom. We're going to have to take greater and greater steps of faith. So let's obey the Lord. Let's see some great things happen for Jesus. Amen. Sister Mary Lee, would you dismiss us, please? Amen. God bless you. Amen. You are dismissed. Amen. Have a wonderful week. God bless you. Amen.